Well, I'm sad that we had to get to this point. We should have never been here. It's unfortunate. I didn't want to have to do this. But the sad part is that I have an obligation to the American people when we see FISA abuse. So these are secret courts that exist to target for foreigners, for catching terrorists, for catching people who might be bad actors. And the American citizens that are represented before this court have to be protected. And the only place that can protect them is the U.S. Congress when abuses do occur.
Did you write
the memo? So it's not a place we wanted to go. It's not a place we wanted to go, but it's where we had to go.
You know that I can't do that. That's not how our legal system works.
Well, I'm gonna have to get
stuff out. Oh!
What if this happened to you guys?
No one can behave like this. I want to make sure it's crystal clear.
You have a lesson, lady.
The lighthouse at Alexandria. Now, Alexandria was a new city in Egypt that was designed and thought of and dreamed of by Alexander the Great. When he went to Egypt, he said, you know, I think I ought to build a capital city, something worthy of myself. And so he started the whole process. Now, if you look on a map, it would be on the northwestern side of the Nile Delta. He said, that's a good spot because we got the Mediterranean here. We can have a port city right here. Plus, we have access to the Nile, so we can have a canal going down that direction. This will be great. The city was designed by an architect with orderly streets. Now, think about this. This is 300s BC. It had streets crossing at right angles, a boulevard 100 feet wide and lined with columns running the length of the city from east to west. It had spacious parks, gardens, palaces. I love this one. Zoos. It had a zoo in Alexandria in 300 BC, a museum, a library that was one of the most amazing libraries in the whole world. It had a 1 mile long breakwater to protect the harbor on the Mediterranean side. They built this breakwater, and out along the breakwater was a little island called Pharos. Now, Alexander the Great died, and the man who took over his job in Alexandria was named Ptolemy. We just mentioned him before. Ptolemy completed the city, and then, strangely enough, he brought Alexander the Great brought his body back and put it in a mausoleum in Alexandria. I don't know, these things are all connected. Alexandria became the center of the cultural world in the early 300s and the late 200s BC. In fact, if you remember about the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, of the Hebrew scriptures, it was done under Ptolemy II in Alexandria. He brought the Jewish scholars from Israel to Alexandria, to this cultural center, to translate the Hebrew scriptures into Greek. So this is Alexandria, okay? This is the place. Now, the first Ptolemy wanted a lighthouse built. So he had a decree in 290 BC to build it, and it was completed under his son Ptolemy II in 270 BC. The lighthouse sat on Pharos Island, and because people would refer to it as, hey, there's the lighthouse on Pharos Island, Pharos Island, eventually they just started calling it Pharos. And that word actually means, in a lot of different languages, or something like Pharos, actually means lighthouse today. Muslim travelers in the 12th century began to describe it. They said it was a certain number of cubits. And unfortunately, we don't know exactly what they meant by cubit. So we're not sure if it was 450 feet or up to 600 feet tall. But it was really a tall building. In fact, if it were still standing today, it would be taller than most of the buildings in the world. Now, I know there are huge skyscrapers in different cities around the world, but this thing, up to 600 feet, this is really a tall building. The base was a square, massive building resting on a heavy stone platform. It was built of white marble, joined not with regular old mortar, but with molten lead. ooh, it sounds difficult to work with, to reinforce this building. Above this was a long, narrow, eight-sided section with a balcony. Guess who that was for? That was for the tourists. Isn't that great? We have in 270 BC a place where the tourists can go and look out to sea and go, wow, isn't this cool? And at the upper end of that, there was another balcony for the more daring sightseers. And 300 to 400 feet above the sea, they could see out. So it was a pretty spectacular place to go. I suppose that's where they would go on their romantic dates with husbands and wives or something. I don't know. Oh, actually, I did read that they had vendors who sold food and everything that were at that first balcony. Now, the third section was cylindrical and led up to the beacon chamber at the very top where there was a fire that was continually burning. One of the Muslim travelers who saw it wrote, "It is kept lit night and day as a beacon for navigators throughout the whole sailing season. Mariners know the fire and direct their course accordingly, for it is visible," get this, "it's visible a day's sail," which they said was 100 miles away. So people could see it out to sea 100 miles. By night, it looks like a brilliant star. By day, one can perceive its smoke. Now, how do you keep a fire burning? Well, they had to bring the fuel up to it constantly. So first they had horse-drawn wagons who could take it up to the top of the first part of the building. And then they had a hoist that actually kind of a dumbwaiter situation. If you know what a dumbwaiter is and a kind of an elevator thing, they would pull it up on this hoist through a central shaft up to the beacon chamber where they would burn the fire. At the very top of this building was a statue of the sea god Poseidon. In 80 BC, Alexandria came under the jurisdiction of Rome. So now it's no longer Greek, it's Roman. Fascinating, when Caesar, Julius Caesar, was in Alexandria, wooing Cleopatra in 47 BC, the library, which was the largest library in the world at that time, was destroyed by a mob rioting against Roman authority. They were really hot, really upset that Julius Caesar had come there, and they saw that he was going to maybe take over the area, and they said no. So they burned the library. I don't know why. Mobs go crazy. Next, Cleopatra hooked up with Mark Antony, but then she committed suicide in 30 BC, so Egypt became a Roman province. Do you remember that Cleopatra was the last of the reigning Ptolemies? She was the last pharaoh, if you will, in the land in Egypt. And so when she committed suicide, it became a Roman province. By the time of Jesus, the population of Alexandria was about 300,000. This was a huge city, and that doesn't even count the number of slaves. So it was really a big city. By the 300s AD, it was an important center for Christianity. Alexandria was one of the main areas where there were a lot of scholars, a lot of people who were searching the scriptures and formulating doctrine. Alexandria was very important in Christianity. In 616 AD, it was captured by Persians. That didn't last very long because in 646 AD, it was captured by Arabs. And then Cairo became the capital of Arab Egypt in the 900s. At the beginning of the 19th century, so in the 1800s, only 4,000 inhabitants lived in Alexandria. But today, it's really bounced back. It's a leading seaport. About 1375 AD, Pharaohs, the lighthouse that we're talking about, was toppled by an earthquake, and it took 100 years to clear the channel where this building collapsed. It made a huge rubble, and it took them 100 years to clean the whole thing up and get the harbor opened up in that area again. In 1480, Kayat Bey, the Sultan of Egypt, built a castle and a fortress on the stump of the tower. They used remnants of the base for their walls. There was fascinating stuff that we saw in a video about the Seven Wonders of the World, how they actually have pieces of the white marble right there in that fortress and that castle. So part of Pharaoh's can be seen today in this fortress and castle of Kayat Bey sitting on what was Pharaoh's Island. Now, this is really the final and wildest thing. There is a mosaic in St. Mark's Cathedral in Venice that showed Mark the Evangelist, the writer of the Gospel of Mark, going to found the Christian church in Egypt. And he sails in this mosaic. He is sailing by the Pharos, by the lighthouse, on his way into Alexandria. Isn't that wild? So That's at least the legend. That's the understanding that Mark left Israel and he went to Alexandria and he went right past the pharaohs. In 868 AD, some Venetians, some people from Venice, snatched the body of Mark out of Alexandria and took it to Venice. This is kind of weird, but the skull was recently returned to Egypt and now lies in the Coptic Cathedral of St. Mark in Cairo. So there you go.
أول شي بتحط بتثبته منيح بتثبته منيح عشان بتاخد مكان التوازن عليها بتعين مسافتها وبتشوف وين يعني مثلا عدو وين مقبلك بأي جهة وبترسم المسافة قديش من هون لعنده بتعين عليه حتى بتشوف حركته قديش تتحرك بس يكون يعني مثلا إنه فيك تتحكم بحركته وقتها فيك تضرب وقتها فيك تجيب هدف ممتاز يعني صار خوف بقلبي قلت يعني مستحيل يعني بدي روح يمكن ما ارجع ضلينا يومين حتى بدأت الحملة بس يعني كنا نحكي يعني كيف رح نتصرف شو رح نعمل هونيكي اذا واجهنا داعش شو رح نساوي يعني كيف يعني فات الخوف بقلبنا من البداية كيف يعني داعش عم تنسحب يعني تقول اني ننبسط يعني اني داعش بسرعه بسهوله عم تنسحب يعني بدايه يعني اخذنا الراويه كلها بقي بس مدرسه تمام بقي بس مدرسه واخرتها شوف فيها الشاحنه كم يوم كلها معبي ماي من المتفجرات تمام وقت الفقاد بدي يفوتوا فجاه تسمع
Just a moment. There is final burn one and two. Two candles coming down.
There they are.
Double sonic booms. down. Beautiful landing. And I see two standing. Perfect.
We proudly stand for the national anthem. We are serving our brave veterans, including giving our veterans choice in their healthcare decisions. African-American unemployment stands at the lowest rate ever recorded. The motto is In God We Trust. We enacted the biggest tax cuts and reforms in American history. We proudly stand for the national anthem. Serving our brave veterans, including giving our veterans choice in their health care decisions. African American unemployment stands at the lowest rate ever recorded. The motto is In God We Trust. We enacted the biggest tax cuts and reforms in American history.
I met Larry Nassar when I was somewhere around the age of 5 years old. My parents had become close friends with Larry and his wife, Stephanie. It was during this time, I estimate I was approximately 6 years old, that Larry Nassar began to sexually abuse me. Perhaps you have figured it out by now, but little girls don't stay little forever. They grow into strong women that return to destroy your world.
Said there's many things that we just haven't had time to really figure out. There's one thing that you need to understand, that I am still a rancher. I still have my cattle. I still own the forage and water. I still own access rights to the land. And I still own my range improvements that's out on the land. And I intend to get a ranch. I intend to be a rancher. I intend to produce food for America, using the renewable resources off the desert, the southwest desert, and I intend to produce a commodity that's good to eat. Red meat, steaks, something good to eat, something for dinner.
what some Christians will say
sure.
is, you know, we shouldn't align with Trump. He's got this horrible background. The rhetoric he uses is terrible. He's not a good representative. So how do you, because they'll say, well, like, how could Christians align with him? You know, they wouldn't align with Bill Clinton. You know, how would they align with him?
I think President Trump is doing wonderful. I think President Trump is getting better. I think he's not a politician and he's learning it quickly. But more important, who was Paul? Who was Paul?
He was once Saul.
He was a Christian terrorist. It would be like if bin Laden walked in the room and said, hey, man, I know what you read about me. I'm not that guy anymore. That was Saul. He was basically the guy. In fact, in the story, when he goes blind and then he runs into another guy who was called, heard the voice of God to go meet him, the guy that was supposed to meet him said, well, there's only one Saul of Tarsus, Lord, and, you know, I'm sure you're wrong on this one. You don't want me to go talk to this guy. And he said, no, that guy, because my ways are not your ways, is my chosen instrument. So right now, Trump is God's chosen instrument, whether we like it or not.
Right now at 6, train to stay calm during chaos, what first responders were up against during Sunday's huge snowstorm.
We're addressing it as quickly and as soon as we can. We're trying to get the whole freeway shut down, but it's going to take time.
Not a good one.
And he was staring at you for going too slow.
Yeah, he was mad at me for going too slow.
Oh, no.
Yep.
Here we go. Oh.
Thank you.
This is like heaven right now.
Yeah. Alexis Bromley is from Nebraska. She needed a break from white people.
In Omaha, it's very segregated. It can be very isolating if you're a person of color. It's hard in Nebraska because it's a red state. And so you just don't know who you interact with on a daily basis, if they believe that you're lesser, if you're inferior, and how that in turn can affect me.
She says the current political climate has only made these feelings worse. So she decided to go on a Women of Color healing retreat in Costa Rica.
Hi, such beautiful smiles. Thank you guys so much for coming. My blackness is bold.
My blackness is uninhibited.
My blackness is strength.
The idea is simple. For 10 days, black women come together to eat vegan food, meditate, do yoga.
The breath in is the reminder that we are safe.
And to discuss the frustrations of being Black in America.
It's like a mental game all the time, and I'm in these spaces where, you know, constantly getting poked and prodded. Oh, let me touch your hair. Oh, you're really pretty for a Black girl.
Black people don't exercise. Black people don't hike. People are automatically gonna have this perception of me before I even open my mouth.
So many people's ideologies are being validated that don't see us as human, that don't see us as people.
This retreat is one of more than a dozen Black-owned travel groups, marketing trips specifically to people who look like Alexis. In the few years that most of these companies have been open, more and more clients are calling them up. At least five say they've seen a spike in interest coinciding with Trump's election.
The idea of Black women reclaiming control over their own mind, body, and spirit is exactly what's needed to survive in a system that constantly tells us that our wellness isn't important. We stopped taking care of ourselves because we were taught, you don't matter.
The retreat is the brainchild of Andrea X, a former Brooklynite turned expat.
I left the United States because I was sick of gentrification, racism, just dealing with being this Black woman, trying to figure it out there.
Thank you.
I actually heard that ABC has a program that compared my Christianity to mental illness. And I'd like to laugh about it, but I really can't. I mean, Mike, I'm a believer. Like tens of millions of Americans today will have ash on their foreheads to mark the beginning of Lent. Overwhelming majority of Americans cherish their faith. And we have all different types of faith in this country. But I tell you, to have ABC maintain a broadcast forum that compared Christianity to mental illness is just wrong. And it's an insult not to me, but to the vast majority of the American people who, like me, cherish their faith. Thank you.
I actually was in the bathroom at the moment, and I had came back to my classroom and I knocked on the door and the fire alarm went off, and principal came on the speaker and just said, everyone needs to evacuate right now. So that's what we did. As I was going down the stairs, I heard a couple shots fired. Everyone was freaking out, saying that it was a gun. And as we were walking, the whole class together, I actually was speaking to the suspect, Nicholas Cruz. And as I was speaking to him, he seemed very, I don't know what the word I want to say is, but he was trouble in middle school. So I kind of joked to him about it and said, I'm surprised you weren't the one who did it. And he just gave me a huh. So that's really what happened.
You were walking down the hall. He had already fired at that time.
Yes, sir, with him.
Weren't you scared?
In the moment I wasn't, because there was obviously definitely another shooter involved, but...
Oh, you think he was not the only one?
No, definitely not.
Why do you say that?
Because when shots were fired, I saw him after the fact. So, and the shots were coming from the other part of the building. So there definitely had to be two shooters involved, I believe.
That's the first I've heard of that. Did you see any other students who were wounded?
No, sir.
They're all in shock. Let me just tell you this. We just spoke with a former student, Aletza Medick. She actually walked down the hall with the accused shooter, Nicholas Cruz, after she heard shots fired. She said, hey, Nicholas, this is what she told me on camera. We will have it for our 10 o'clock show. She said, hey, I just heard shots fired. I'm surprised it wasn't you. Just kidding like that. He had his reaction, what? And then they parted ways. She said, I heard more shots after that. She thinks there was a second shooter. That's the first we've heard of that, but she believes there was actually a second shooter. We'll see if that comes about or not again. Authorities still inside searching. Now, more on Nicholas Cruz. I spoke with a number of students. Like I said, one of those was Adam Habona, a sophomore here at the high school, used to be a neighbor to Nicholas Cruz. Here's part of our conversation.
So everyone started saying it was Nicholas Cruz. I was not surprised. I really wasn't. I'd see him sometimes, and he was never doing, like, one time he stole something out of my neighbor's garage. The other time he was throwing coconuts at the houses. He's just not a good kid.
How do you go back to school now?
I don't know if I can. I really don't. That image is not going to be able to leave my head. It's horrific. It's really horrific. Seeing two children, what, 15 or 16 years old, laying down like that, it's insane. There's no way to describe it.
Adam told me he was on a first floor classroom. A young girl ripped open the door and dove into his classroom. He said, I saw a bullet hole in her leg. She was bleeding profusely. Someone put a tourniquet on her. He hopes that she's all right. We hope, of course, that she is. Again, a lot of questions about Nicholas Cruz. And what we do know are the students that knew him had a lot of question marks about him. He seemed like a troubled student. And at some point, authorities hopefully will find out exactly the motive behind this horrendous day here in Parkland, Florida.
All the kids to go outside so they could start shooting up. So they start shooting from the first floor up, because there's only two exits in the freshman building. So everybody started running to the other exits. So that's when the other shooter started coming up. So everybody, and then I thank God to this teacher who opened up her door, and like all of us, and she got shot in the arm trying to open the door. And then the other teacher, he got shot in the head trying to cut the other students. And it was like an hour, like it felt like years waiting for them. And then after all that, we finally got out, and like they started yelling at us to keep focused and to pay attention ahead, the army people, because they didn't want us to see the bodies that they hid in the corner. They were putting mats over them so we wouldn't see them. But there was dust all over the floor from the weird thing they threw in there.
Do you think there was more than one shooter?
There's three shooters. Right. Definitely.
How terrifying. Hold on one second, ma'am. How terrifying.
It was pretty damn terrifying because they were putting us through drills, and we all thought this
I'll
was
call
a
you
drill.
Right back.
We thought this was a drill, but it wasn't. And then we just started hearing the gunshots. And it was really terrifying because my class, the class that I ran into, he started shooting through the door, and he came through, and he started shooting the cabinets, and that's when he shot the teacher. And then they started, and then he ran back outside to shoot the other teacher who was closing the other door for the kids. But he didn't get to close the door, and he was just there. And so we were all just sushing each other, like, shut up, just suck it up if you're crying, because we're not trying to get shot. Because he was in the hallway yelling, hey, trying to taunt us and get us to say things, trying to get us outside. And that's when some other kid, like, he ran out because he thought it was free, but he got shot, and then we heard the groaning outside, and we couldn't do anything.
What, so the shooter, tell me, besides, hey, what was he saying during
He wasn't doing anything. He was legit. He just ran up the stairs, started shooting, and you could see a bunch of kids just going down that way, but stopping, but because the other shooter was coming. So everybody was
screaming and stuff?
Everybody was trampling each other, because they were like, hey, do you hear that loud banging sound? And we all thought it was like some kid joking on the stairwell because they're hollow, so you could just hit a stick and it sounds like it. But then we all were like, oh, this is real. So we all just started running. It was really...
Now, one student told me that the shooter was wearing a bulletproof vest and a helmet. Did you see that?
I saw some other kid. The other kid who came into the classroom, he was wearing some type of thing, and, like, I don't know. But it was like, I froze at that moment, because you never know, because when the gun is, like, pointed towards you and the thing, you don't know what to do. And you kind of just, like, pause, and you're just like, is this actually going to happen? But I felt like he was going after all the teachers, because a bunch of teachers got shot. And any of the kids who were in the way, they got shot.
That actually mock praying for people. They say, oh, do gun control,
try
but pray
it.
For
it's
people.
So trite.
I needed those prayers. Those prayers helped me and my family at a really difficult time, and you could feel them. These families need prayer. They need counseling. They need help. But look, let's go find out the root of these problems. And we're already seeing there were so many things that slipped through the cracks. The telltale signs were there. I mean, when every kid in the school says, geez, I mean, this kid was the one that we knew would be a shooter.
Yeah.
Why didn't anybody else know about that? I mean, these are the problems we need to go address.
Bill Clinton today tweeted about the assault weapons ban. He said, look, in my 10 years or so, the assault weapon ban was in place, 94 to 2004. He couldn't have gotten that particular weapon. What do you respond to?
You know, you go find your law that was going to prevent this or the next shooting. And first of all, whatever criminal did these actions violated a whole host of other laws, too. So if you think there's some magic unicorn law that's going to stop it from happening, just keep in mind, he violated probably dozens of laws already, including murdering people. It's against the law. So, you know, this idea that one magic law is going to stop the next one from happening, it's not. What you do see in common, number one, you see a lot of mental illness in common, but you also see gun-free zones. Shooters know that if you go to a gun-free zone, you're the only one with
soft
a gun
target.
And nobody else has. Fortunately with me, I had two law enforcement agents that were with me that had guns that could counter the shooter. And ultimately, that's what took him down. It was other people with guns that took down the shooter. Every day in America, there are people that use guns to stop crimes, to defend their own families. That's what our founding fathers wrote about, by the way. They believed in an innate right of people to have guns for self-defense. And these people that want to take away your rights, guised under all of these tragedies, go pray for the families. Care about these families. Don't try to promote your agenda in the middle of a tragedy.
Yet another family being reunited at this moment. Alyssa Hyman has their story. Alyssa.
Right. Well, Michael, this student just got out of the high school. She's still waiting to see her dad at this point. But you were really where all of this was unfolding. This is Maddie. She's a junior at the high school. Just tell me what you saw.
We were coming out of the classroom because we heard shots, but then the fire drill came on. So we thought, oh, it must be just somebody was moving something heavy. It was like very rapid shots. And then when we were walking down the hall, I was waiting with my teacher, Ms. LaPelle. I heard one shot, and then it hit the wall, and like the wall came down and was like coming on my leg, just like little bits of dust and stuff. And then I ran back into the classroom, and I was so scared that I just immediately opened up one of the closets, and they had shelves inside, so I was hanging on the inside of the shelves. At first backwards, but then I was able to turn around and look through the crack in the closet, and I saw somebody run past, and then bunch more gunshots, and then somebody run backwards and run more gunshots, and then I was so scared, and eventually after like about 30 minutes or so, I was watching and I saw, like, I heard people screaming, help, help me. And I was really scared. And then I saw through the window a policeman come through with lasers and the probably SWAT. And I came out of the closet like with my hands up, and he was like immediately like, go over there and line up single file. And when I went towards the door, I saw on the floor a grown man, probably a teacher. And then when we were leaving the classroom, they were all telling us to run, not to look, just keep looking down. But there was a boy by the bathroom, two girls holding each other by the girls' bathroom, and a boy kind of face up against the wall by the stairs with blood all over the wall and holes in him.
And I know she's shaking right now, so if I ask anything that's too much, you tell me, okay? But you mentioned that one of the people that you saw on the ground was one of your friends. I don't want you to say his name, but obviously this is so upsetting, not just to have gone through this, but to have seen that.
Yes, it was very upsetting. We were making hearts together. He was in my class, and we were making hearts for his girlfriend and my boyfriend.
And obviously you're still trying to find your dad. You've spoken to him. He knows you're safe. Do you have other friends that you haven't yet heard from? I mean, what's going through your mind right now?
Right at the moment, it's like, was there any more shootings anywhere else? Was everybody okay? Are my friends okay? I don't have contact because my phone is dead. I was so frightened, and I couldn't even get my phone to talk to my dad because my phone was vibrating in my pocket, but I was hanging on so hard. And then I like started to slip because my arms were getting so tired. And I was like, no, if this is real, then I don't want to have my feet showing on the ground. And it was so terrifying. I thought it was fake at first. I thought they were just trying to test us. But when I came around the corner and I saw the man on the floor.
And you saw a lot of blood?
There was blood everywhere.
And tell me what the process was like, because I know you said you saw an officer and you came out with your hands up outside of the closet, but what was that process like before you were finally able to leave the school? Because I know you're shaken. This obviously happened a while ago and we were still waiting to get and find your father. What was that process like before you left the school?
It was like he was like saying, look down, everybody put your hands up and just keep, like, he's like, I need you to run, I need you to go. And we were running down the stairs and I was trying not to slip. There was blood all over the floor and it was terrifying. And it was just so much adrenaline. And before I came out of the closet, I turned and looked, and there was like police cars and dogs and SWAT and everything, and it was terrifying.
And obviously, do you know where you're gonna meet your dad? I know you said your cell phone is dead.
He said right here on University.
Okay. Yeah. Anything else that you want to say, or that you saw, or that you heard, that you want us to know about what happened? Obviously, traumatizing for you.
Yeah, it was just a bunch of screaming, saying help me. He was like screaming, and I thought it was a joke. I thought he must not be, like, because they told us that they were gonna have like fake, you know, and have people being taken away and like have them scream or whatever. So I was like, it must be
like
fake.
In a school drill, like,
yeah,
is that
like a drill? And so I just figured it was that, but it was like so real. I could hear his voice. He was very, very, like, gasping.
Now, I know you told me you didn't know the guy who was shooting and you hardly saw him, but of what you saw, can you tell me what you saw? You didn't know him?
It was just a split. There was like two people run past and it was just black. I couldn't see anything. And the slit that I was looking through was so thin that it was just like, right, like one, two.
Was he saying anything? Was he screaming?
I heard laughing.
Laughing?
Right when they walked through the door. And then I heard people run down the stairs, and then that was it for a little while. And then it was just somebody screaming, help me.
And just so everybody knows, so this was in the freshman building. For those who aren't familiar
third
with the school,
floor,
it was
building.
Third floor of the freshman building. Explain what the layout of the school is like. So there's more than one building. And
it's just the freshman building is separate from the entire school. There's one floor which has one aisle and it has doors on all sides. And then another floor has an aisle and another floor has an aisle. I was on the top at the very end of the back. So the staircase was right by the door.
All right, well, listen, I want you to go find your dad. If you need a cell phone number to call, let me know. All right, I know your phone is dead. We want to send it back to Michael.
Here's a piece of that Iranian drone, or what's left of it after we shot it down. I brought it here so you can see it for yourself. Mr. Zarif, do you recognize this? You should. It's yours. You can take back with you a message to the tyrants of Tehran. Do not test Israel's resolve.
administration now in Seoul has invited South Korea's president to visit Pyongyang. That's right, the capital of North Korea. The invitation was given on behalf of North Korean leader Kim Jong-un by his sister. You see her screen right there. Kim Yo-jong met South Korean President Moon Jae-in during a historic meeting at South Korea's presidential palace, the Blue House. Kim Yo-jong and North Korea's ceremonial head of state are in South Korea to attend the Winter Games. You see him there, screen right. President Moon hopes the Games will improve relations between the two Koreas. Paul, if I can ask you to dig into your years of insights based on reporting on this country, how significant, how big is this news?
Well, Cyril, this is significant. Kim Jong-un, the North Korean leader, has extended a personal invitation to the South Korean president, Moon Jae-in. It is significant, absolutely. It was a letter that was hand-delivered by Kim Jong-un's sister, Kim Yo-jong. She was here for the Pyeongchang Olympics, but obviously the politics has gone a lot further than just attending the opening ceremony and the niceties of shaking hands.
My father has traveled the world preaching and proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ, that God loves sinners, that he's willing to forgive sin, but he's been burdened for our country and the spiral that we have caught ourselves in. You see, we're in trouble morally, politically, spiritually, economically, at every level. People want to know who can save us. God can save us, and he's wanting to save us. And the message that you're about to hear from my father is a message he believes that can not only change the direction of our nation, but it can change the direction of your life for eternity.
Young Billy Graham hailed another Billy Sunday.
Reverend Billy Graham, one of the most inspirational spiritual leaders of the 20th century.
Thank you for coming, Billy Graham.
Would you welcome his evangelist, author, educator, Dr. Billy Graham.
Our recipient, the man who honors us by being here today.
What is your purpose?
Go into the whole world and proclaim this message.
You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
Shall make you free. Shall make you free.
As I look back over my life, it's full of surprises. I never thought I would become friends with people in different countries all over the world.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son.
I want us to look at the cross tonight.
I see how God's hand guided me.
Love one another.
When I began preaching many years ago, it was not with any thoughts that I'd be preaching to large audiences.
Come to the cross. His gospel is for everyone.
God has done this. Our country's in great need of a spiritual awakening. Well, there have been times that I've wept as I've gone from city to city and I've seen how far people have wandered from God. Of all the things that I've seen and heard, there's only one message that can change people's lives and hearts.
There is a way if you come by the way of the cross.
I want to tell people about the meaning of the cross. Not the cross that hangs on a wall or around someone's neck.
We receive our freedom purchased by the ransom at the cross.
But the real cross of Christ.
The cross expresses the great love of God for man.
It's scarred and bloodstained. His was a rugged cross.
His real purpose for coming was to die.
I know that many will react to this message, but it is the truth. And with all my heart, I want to leave you with the truth.
God says, I love you. I love you. I love you with an everlasting love.
That he loves you, willing to forgive you of all your sins.
On our churches, we have a cross. It's embossed on our Bibles, on our Bibles.
I thought the cross was a relic. It was a medallion on a necklace at best.
It's an ornament that we wear around our necks, Christians and non-Christians.
The cross really didn't have any meaning to me except for something artistic that rock stars wore.
But talk about the depth and the real meaning of the cross, and it becomes an offense. Why is that?
The cross is offensive because it confronts people. Even so, It's a confrontation that all of us must face.
I was really hurting and just didn't understand the source of all my pain and problems.
Scott Peterson was absolutely on campus through this entire event. He was armed. He was in uniform. After seeing video, witness statements, and Scott Peterson's very own statement, I decided this morning to suspend Scott Peterson without pay, pending an internal investigation. As is his right, Scott Peterson chose to resign because he has the necessary time with the agency and meets the requirements of retirement. He resigned and / retired. The investigation will continue. We're not going to disclose the video at this time, and we may never disclose the video, depending on the prosecution and the criminal case. But what I saw was a deputy arrive at the west side of Building 12, take up a position, and he never went in.
We are joined here today by Palestinian Authority President Abbas. I'm sorry he declined to stay in the chamber to hear the remarks of others. Even though he has left the room, I will address the balance of my remarks to him. President Abbas, when the new American administration came into the office last January, we did so against the fresh backdrop of the passage of Security Council Resolution 2334. In the waning days of the previous American administration, the United States made a serious error in allowing that resolution to pass. Resolution 2334 was wrong on many levels. I'm not going to get into the substance now. But beyond the substance, perhaps its biggest flaw was that it encouraged the false notion that Israel can be pushed into a deal that undermines its vital interests, damaging the prospects for peace by increasing mistrust between the Israelis and the Palestinians. In the last year, the United States has worked to repair that damage. At the UN, I have opposed the bias against Israel, as any ally should do. But that does not mean I or our administration is against the Palestinian people. Just the opposite is true. We recognize the suffering of the Palestinian people, as I have recognized here today. I sit here today offering the outstretched hand of the United States to the Palestinian people in the cause of peace. We are fully prepared to look to a future of prosperity and coexistence. We welcome you as the leader of the Palestinian people here today. But I will decline the advice I was recently given by your top negotiator, Saeb Erekat. I will not shut up. Rather, I will respectfully speak some hard truths. The Palestinian leadership has a choice to make between two different paths. There's the path of absolutist demands, hateful rhetoric, and incitement to violence. That path has led and will continue to lead to nothing but hardship for the Palestinian people. Or there is the path of negotiation and compromise. History has shown that path to be successful for Egypt and Jordan, including the transfer of territory. That path remains open to the Palestinian leadership, if only it is courageous enough to take it. The United States knows the Palestinian leadership was very unhappy with the decision to move our embassy to Jerusalem. You don't have to like that decision. You don't have to praise it. You don't even have to accept it. But know this, that decision will not change. So once again, you must choose between two paths. You can choose to denounce the United States, reject the U.S. role in peace talks, and pursue punitive measures against Israel in international forums like the UN. I assure you that path will get the Palestinian people exactly nowhere toward the achievement of their aspirations. Or you can choose to put aside your anger about the location of our embassy and move forward with us toward a negotiated compromise that holds great potential for improving the lives of the Palestinian people. Putting forward old talking points and entrenched and undeveloped concepts achieves nothing. That approach has been tried many times and has always failed. After so many decades, we welcome new thinking. As I mentioned in this meeting last month, the United States stands ready to work with the Palestinian leadership. Our negotiators are sitting right behind me, ready to talk. But we will not chase after you. The choice, Mr. President, is yours. Thank you.
Our top story tonight, a plane with malfunctioning landing gear was saved from disaster by a pickup truck.
I mean, I was right out here. I was afraid for the people on the plane.
Like the front wheels weren't coming down, and so it needed help landing.
Inside the terminal, passengers awaiting their flights watched it all unfold.
And we heard this, like, huge commotion, and everyone rushed toward the window.
Yeah.
We see an airplane coming in, and it's gonna crash or so, I think.
This truck just comes out of nowhere, and it just, like, came right under it, and the plane landed right on top of the truck.
Meanwhile, inside the aircraft, passengers had been expecting the worst.
The captain did explain we were going to be just circling. We could hear the grinding. That was really frightening.
The truck, a Nissan Frontier, was driven by an airport mechanic. He says he doesn't consider himself a hero.
I heard it coming over the radio. The plane was coming in, so I just had to gas it, get it up to full speed. You know, got the Pro 4X off-roading package, so this thing can handle some pretty rugged stuff.
More, including reaction from pilots and air traffic control. That's coming up tonight at 11.
Thank you.
officer was behind a stairwell wall, just standing there, and he had his gun drawn, and he was just pointing it at the building. And you could, shots started going off inside. You could hear them going off over and over again.
Brandon says Coach Aaron Feist risked his life and ran inside to help, but he says Officer Peterson didn't move.
He was pointing his gun at nothing. He was pointing his gun at just a building with kids in it, and he was just talking on the radio, and he never did anything for 4 minutes.
This is the freshman building where Nicholas Cruz went on his shooting rampage. Brandon says Officer Peterson was behind a stairwell in this adjacent building during the shooting. Here's another angle. This is the stairwell where Officer Peterson remained, never going inside to try and stop the shooter.
He's the only one with a gun. He's wearing a bulletproof vest, and all, you know, he has all that while school security guards, you know, coaches pretty much, were running in, shielding kids. Coach Feist, Hickson, were running in, shielding kids from bullets and losing their lives while he did nothing.
We tried talking to Officer Peterson at his Boynton Beach home, but were turned away by Palm Beach County deputies who were guarding his house. If Brandon could say something to Peterson, this is what he would want to tell him.
You're despicable. You know, you didn't do your job. You were trained for this. You were armed. You were, had a bulletproof vest. You were protected more than anybody else who died, who lost their lives, and you did nothing. You froze. You got scared. You know, you did nothing at all, and you could have saved a lot of lives.
From a large tent in Los Angeles to 100,000 people in a single day at Yankee Stadium to more than 2 million people at Madison Square Garden over 16 weeks in 1957. And I remember that because my father said to me, come on, son. And by the way, he said, come on, mom, let's go see Billy Graham at Yankee Stadium, and it was something very special. But Americans came in droves to hear that great young preacher. Fred Trump was a big fan. Fred Trump was my father.
The Mausoleum of Halicarnassus. Where is Halicarnassus? It was another Greek city on the coast of Asia Minor. If you're looking, if you found where Ephesus was, in fact, if you look at your Bible and look in the Bible maps at the back of the book, you can find Ephesus. About 60 miles south of there was the city of Halicarnassus. Herodotus, that wanderer, storyteller, historian kind of a guy, he was from there in the middle of the 5th century BC. And in the next century, a man came to power by the name of Messalus. Now, Messalis was descended from the indigenous people of the time. He was not Greek. He was not a Greek at all. He was from the indigenous people, the Carius, and he became their king. He came to power in 377 BC, and his capital city was Halicarnassus. So he had kind of an empire, well, kind of a big country, but this place was his capital city. And his wife was Queen Artemisia, named after Artemis. You can see the relation there. He died in 353 BC, and she wanted so to honor him that she said, I want to build the most beautiful temple, the most splendid tomb that the world has ever seen. So she sent out her advertising copy all over the known Greek world, and she said, no expense spared, I want the best workers. Well, those days were not that different from these days when artists and craftsmen hear, hey, no expense spared, we want the best. They say, okay, we're traveling over to Halicarnassus. And so they had some of the best people, including Scopas, the man who was the architect for the Temple of Artemis up in Ephesus. Scopas came to work on this, as well as lots of other of the best workers in the Greek world at that time. 2 years later, Artemisia dies. I mean, there goes the bank account. But the work on the mausoleum, the tomb for Messalis, was incomplete. But according to Pliny, the sculptors chose to remain and finish their work, considering that it was at once a memorial of their own fame and of the sculptor's art. So they're part of the way through the project. They say, you know what, if we quit, it's not going to look so good. If we finish and it's one of the most wonderful buildings ever built, they're going to say, hey, Scopas and all these other guys, they're really good. So they kept going. The term mausoleum, which we use today, comes from this man, this ruler named Messalis. Okay? The mausoleum at Halicarnassus had a wall. Picture this. On the outside, there was a wall that enclosed a big rectangular courtyard. And in the center of that area, there was a stone platform with marble steps. Now, by the marble steps, they had sculptured lions. Now, we know that because we found them later. I didn't, but other people did. Found the sculptured lions that had guarded the staircase. There was a platform that had a second wall with statues of warriors on it. And above that was the tomb. Now, the tomb where they actually had Messalis and, since she died, Artemisia, they both had their coffins in there. The tomb stood on a square marble base. And above that were columns made out of marble. There were 9 to a side, 36 columns in all. And then that on top, so you got the picture now, you have a tomb on a platform. You have these big old marble columns rising up, and supporting on top of the marble columns is a huge pyramid, a structure of a pyramid. And on top of the pyramid, it's like, yeah, if you can't top that, let's try this. On top of the pyramid was this huge statue. It was a marble chariot drawn by 4 marble horses with 2 passengers in it. And guess who the passengers were? Messalis and Artemisia. Not really them, but statues of them in marble standing up in the chariot. Now, the chariot and the figures were 25 feet high. The total height of the mausoleum was 140 feet. In addition to that, there are all kinds of Greek paintings and sculptures and all that stuff, all the Greek things that they have on there. But this is really impressive, and the people that saw it said, this is one of the ancient wonders of the world. Alexander the Great came to this area in 334 BC, and you know, the city of Halicarnassus almost stopped him, almost defeated him. When he broke through the eastern wall of the city, they built another inner wall of brick real quickly, and then they went on the offensive, and they almost defeated Alexander. But you know, that made him mad. So if you cause him problems, when he comes in and finally wins, he kind of destroys the city. So he destroyed a lot of the city, but evidently the mausoleum was left untouched. Now, in the 200s BC, that area of Asia Minor came under the control of the Ptolemies of Egypt, and then eventually it acquired the name Bodrum, which is what they call it today. So if you look on a map, you might find Bodrum. In the 1400s AD, there was an earthquake, and that finally tumbled the columns of the mausoleum, and the pyramid fell off, and the statues fell off, and that all kind of fell apart. And right in that time period, the Knights of St. John, which was a crusading group of knights, they came to this area, to Bodrum. They decided to build a castle, a fortified castle, so they could protect pilgrims going to the Holy Land. And so they built this fortified castle out of stones that they got, a lot of them, from that area around the mausoleum. So in 1522, the Turks did not like having these Knights of St. John there, so they planned an invasion of Bodrum Castle. So the knights, knowing this was coming, they fortified it. They went and broke into, finally found the coffins of Mausolus and Artemisia at this point, and they took the stone lions and all this different stuff, and they incorporated it into Bodrum Castle. But when the Turks invaded, the knights fled. They lost. And so the Bodrum Castle came under Muslim control. Then in 1846, the British Museum, which was really getting into this whole new science of archaeology, the British Museum acquired some of these pieces straight from the mausoleum at Halicarnassus that was incorporated into Bodrum Castle. In 1856, the British archaeologist Charles Thomas Newton went to search for other pieces of the mausoleum. So they found all these in Bodrum Castle, and he said, I wonder what else is out there. And so he went looking all around the area, and he found the stone lions at Bodrum Castle. And at the site of the mausoleum, he found slabs of the sculptured reliefs of the Greeks and the Amazons. Remember the Amazons from the Hittites? They had sculptured reliefs as part of the mausoleum, and they found part of the pyramid and the chariot wheel from the sculpture on top of the pyramid. And then, amazingly, he found the statues, the marble statues of Mausolus and Artemisia from the chariot. And all of that is at the British Museum in the mausoleum room. So if you ever get a chance to go see it, that's where it is. The statue of Zeus at Olympia, which is in Greece. Now, the first date that we can actually get a hold of in Greek history and have verification of was 776 BC. And what was that? Well, it was the date of the first Olympic Games at Olympia. Olympia, what was Olympia? Well, it was, to the ancient Greeks, it was sort of a cross between Mecca, you know, where the Muslims go and worship in Mecca, and Wimbledon, where they have the tennis games, right? It was this incredible connection between sports and religion. Olympia, where's it located? It's on the northwestern part of the southern peninsula of Greece in the area of the Peloponnesus. Look on a map, get your understanding of where it was. At the time of the Olympics, now they were run every 4 years, every time they had an Olympics, a truce was declared for anybody who was coming to the games and to worship Zeus. And so people came from all over Greece. Now, if you remember anything about Greek history, these guys are always fighting each other. All these different city-states are always fighting. But I tell you, at the time of the Olympics, they just said, okay, there's a truce on. You can all come. Nobody fights. Everything's great. So they came. The Temple of Zeus was built in the 5th century BC. That was the one that was the big one. That was the one that housed the statue that became known as one of the ancient wonders of the world. It replaced several smaller temples that had been on that site. It was finished about 456 BC or so. And inside the temple, they didn't have much. They liked kind of the stark look. They didn't have a lot of things hanging around, but they did have one of the ancient wonders of the world. It was a statue of Zeus made by a man named Phidias of Athens. He was one of the greatest of the Greek sculptors, and he built this thing. It was 40 feet tall. The head of Zeus was up by the roof of the temple. He was sitting down so that when people looked at him, they thought, man, if he stands up, he's going to go right through the roof. But of course, he never did stand up. He just kept sitting there the whole time. It was made of ivory and plates of gold that were attached to a wooden framework. He sat on a large golden throne that had precious stones embedded in it, and there was a golden footstool, which was right at the eyeball level of the people who came to worship. So this is kind of an impressive thing. The people that came and looked at it, and they're worshiping Zeus and all that stuff, they're going, wow, this is really incredible, and we made this god. Okay, so there he is. Interesting thing, in 167 BC, Antiochus Epiphanes, Antiochus Epiphanes is the guy from Syria, the Seleucid ruler, who had gone to Jerusalem and sacrificed a pig on the altar and set up a statue of Zeus in the temple at Jerusalem. All right, he did all the things that made the Maccabeans crazy. he brought a woolen curtain to the temple of Zeus in Olympia in Greece and dedicated it to Zeus. And a book that I was reading said they believe that this might possibly have been the temple veil, which had been stolen from Jerusalem. Now, isn't that weird to think about? Okay, let's go into AD. In 391 AD, Emperor Theodosius I banned the pagan cults. Okay, Christianity has taken over, so he bans these pagan cults and he closed the temples. And so they quit having the Olympic Games, because remember, it was a combination of religion and sports. So they just discontinued and the whole area was abandoned. According to the book, The Seven Wonders of the Ancient World by Peter Clayton and Martin Price, now I wanted to quote that because I've seen some different things in different books, but they said that the statue of Zeus was actually transported to Constantinople. So you ban the games, you ban the pagan cults, but you take the statue of Zeus over to Constantinople. In 462 AD, there was a severe fire in Constantinople and it destroyed the palace where the statue of Zeus was housed. So it was gone. Now, in the 1800s, archaeologists began uncovering the site of the Olympic Games, and they found the stadium and the temple and the workshop area. And the funny thing to me, they found what they believe was Phidias's workshop, the guy that built the statue of Zeus, and they identified it because they found a little clay pot that said, "I belong to Phidias." So there you go. And to finish it off, in 1896, the Olympics were revived, and you're probably all familiar with that.
Isn't it amazing to consider how the people of the Bible are so interwoven into many of these seven wonders of the ancient world? Think about it. Joseph and Moses, they both had positions of authority in the land of Egypt. Perhaps they saw the Great Pyramid of Cheops as they traveled the land to fulfill their own responsibilities. Remember, the Great Pyramid is the only one of the seven wonders still standing, and it was standing in the days of Joseph and Moses. Daniel was among the wise men and counselors of King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. He surely saw the amazing walls of the city. And do you remember at one time, prior to the Pharos of Alexandria being built, the walls of Babylon were numbered among the seven wonders of the ancient world. Perhaps Daniel even walked with King Nebuchadnezzar in the Hanging Gardens. I don't know. This is kind of wild to consider, but it makes it come alive, doesn't it? As we say, these people in the Bible, they're actually interconnected, interwoven in with some of the most amazing monuments that man ever created on the face of the earth. The statue of Zeus and the temple of Zeus may have had, as I mentioned, the curtain from the temple in Jerusalem, which was to separate the Holy of Holies from the rest of the temple. It was brought, if in fact this legend is true, it was brought by one described in the book of Daniel. In Daniel chapter 11, verses 31 and 32, the man's name was Antiochus Epiphanes. This guy prophesied about in the book of Daniel is the one, according to the story, that took the curtain all the way to the temple of Zeus. How wild is that? There is no record of the Apostle Paul going to Olympia, to that place of religious celebration and athletic competition, but he did preach to the Greeks at Mars Hill in Athens. God was very concerned about this people group and wanted to connect with them. The Temple of Artemis was financially impacted by the ministry of Paul, as described in the book of Acts, chapter 19. Isn't it wild to consider that even this most magnificent work of man, remember it was twice as big as the Parthenon, it was considered one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. I mean, they didn't give that title away just to anybody. This was an incredible thing. And the religious influence behind it, remember it wasn't just a, wow, that's a cool monument, but it was actually a temple where people worshiped and sacrificed. And so this religious influence behind it, both the temple and the influence were no match for the gospel. The good news of Jesus, the Son of God. Remember that the temple, after a short time after the gospel coming, the temple just sort of fell away and was sunk into the bog and not found for hundreds and hundreds of years later. The mausoleum is the one wonder which seems to have no connection to the Bible, but I found it fascinating that it was the European knights who fought in the Crusades as Christians who took part of the mausoleum and integrated this into Bodrum Castle. So it's not in the Bible, and these knights were not necessarily soul winning evangelists, you know what I'm talking about, but it is connected into church history as well. And as we've discovered, the Colossus of Rhodes only stood for 56 years. So it was lying in the harbor when the Apostle Paul sailed by the island. Now, there's nothing that tells us this, but I've wondered, did he see the gleaming bronze of this Colossus in the harbor from his ship? Did he know about these seven wonders? I don't know, but it's really fun to consider. And finally, the Pharos of Alexandria. Though the Gospel of Mark and Acts does not talk about Mark's adventures in Egypt, it seems fairly certain that the biblical Mark, the evangelist, went to Egypt, probably to Alexandria, to bring the good news of the kingdom to the Egyptians. And so this person is connected into the city, again, where one of the seven wonders of the ancient world was located. Isn't that incredible? As we conclude this in-depth look at the seven wonders of the ancient world, I would like to read Acts chapter 17, verses 24 to 30, and contrast God's ways with the ways of man, which are the motivating force behind many of the seven wonders of the ancient world. As we look at man's monuments and then consider God's involvement in the world, we will begin to understand how paltry is our effort, how quickly our works fade. He is so much more to be praised. He has left a permanent legacy in history, as well as an ongoing monumental work in each of our lives. Have you ever thought about it? You are a wonder, not of the ancient world, but of the modern world, as God does his work in you. He has worked in the different peoples of the world, setting up situations and circumstances that they might know him. Now, listen, this is from Paul's speech at Mars Hill. God, who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands. Now that speaks directly to the worship of Zeus at the temple of Zeus in ancient Greece and the worship of Artemis at the temple of Artemis in Ephesus. Those were two of the seven wonders of the ancient world. Continuing on in Acts chapter 17, nor is he worshiped with men's hands as though he needed anything, since he gives to all life, breath, and all things. And he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their habitation. Notice that God determined the boundaries. Now, the Great Wall of Babylon, which was one of the original seven wonders before the Pharos, the lighthouse at Alexandria, was built, that was man's attempt to set the boundaries. And setting boundaries isn't a bad thing, but we see that those boundaries faded away, and yet what God has done remains, so that they should seek the Lord in the hope that they might grope for him and find him. See, it's not in the massive preparations for the afterlife like the Great Pyramid, which was really just a tomb for the afterlife of the Pharaoh, or the mausoleum at Halicarnassus, which was a tomb to show the greatness and devotion of that couple. Going on in Acts 17, though he is not far from each one of us, for in him we live and move and have our being, as also some of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. Therefore, since we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone, something shaped by art and man's devising. Not like the Colossus of Rhodes. That's not a true representation of God. Truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now, after Jesus coming, now it doesn't say that, I'm adding that in there, after the advent of Jesus, but now God commands all men everywhere to repent. And I think that that final of the seven wonders of the ancient world, the lighthouse of Alexandria, really does provide for us a visual picture of the light going out into the darkness. Jesus is the light of the world, and he leads people safely home, just like a lighthouse leads the ship safely home. My prayer for you is that whenever you read of or hear about the seven wonders of the ancient world, you'll be reminded of how they were interwoven into the lives and adventures of people of the Bible. But not only that, that these ancient wonders fashioned by man also will remind you of the surpassing greatness and superiority of our God and his ways. Amen. Amen.